Good evening, YouTube. Good evening, everyone. And please welcome back my regular guests, Ben.
Howdy. I have a YouTube channel now. It's Spider42B, I think? Something like that.
Aha. Uh-huh. And James?
Hello there. This is James Escroft, UJ's1978. And then I said, the Daleks are gone forever.
Well,
they won't be
fair,
following us.
to be fair, A, this is pretty epic.
Oh, I'm not making fun of... I can only make fun of this serial with 40-plus years of hindsight. Yes, the serial in itself is awesome.
Yes, I totally forgot.
Go ahead.
Sorry. The idea of the Daleks actually having names is really important. Because this is the first serial you've ever seen three Daleks actually have names, and that ends up being a huge thing back in later in 2005 era.
I did mean to come to that. All new series, all the Russell T. Davis Dalek stories, played with the same theme of what makes a Dalek a Dalek, what makes a human a human. So Dalek had a Dalek acquiring Rose's humanity and eventually committing suicide.
Right.
There were Daleks made from humans by a Dalek emperor who'd survived and gone insane.
Right.
And therefore had a kind of human emotionality due to its insanity, and if the Daleks had a bit of human left in them. Then there was the Cult of Skaro. James hasn't seen that one. But the point of those Daleks was that they could feel and imagine, and they had identity. So it was Dalek Khan, Dalek Sek. Was there one? I can't
kind
remember.
Of
three
throwing,
more. Yeah.
Kind of throwing back to this one where it's Alpha, Beta, and Omega, which Omega, later on in Third Doctor, especially Fifth Doctor, the name comes back to haunt the Doctor. So it's really interesting, way before the mythos of Gallifrey.
Well, Omega is the last letter of the Greek alphabet. It's reused because there's a Time Lord God called Omega. We first meet him in the Three Doctors. That's the third Doctor story. And of course there's the Hand of Omega as well.
The name is not relevant in and of itself. It's not that the Dalek is in any way connected to them, or the name is any way connected to them. It's just if we called him Zed or Z for our American friends.
Fine.
Fact that something else is called Z is irrelevant.
It actually does bother me that it isn't Alpha, Beta, and Gamma, because that would have made sense.
They tried that, but it didn't sound as cool when they were singing it. Alpha, Beta, Omega. Alpha, Beta, Omega.
The Dalek dance.
Yes, to start from the beginning, Alex, now that we've had this little segue, the overall structure of the story, the synopsis, and your personal appraisal.
Right. Because of the time of year this is, I haven't had a chance to prepare something written like I normally do. But it doesn't really matter, because I can be anecdotal. As a kid, listening to the audio of this with Tom Baker's narration, where you're basically getting the Fourth Doctor telling you what happened to him back when he was the Second Doctor. That's the approach that they took to these missing episodes. Although there was less of Evil of the Daleks then. They found one, possibly two episodes. So some of the episodes we've seen were lost when I was a kid. I always found it the most epic Dalek story. And when they say a final end, this is the end of the Daleks, it was the height of Dalek mania. Doctor Who was supposed to end with Patrick Troughton. This, in fact, is the last Dalek story for 5 or 6 years. But this was supposed to be... Let that sink in. It's the 60s, every kid has Clockwork Dalek, Dalek Money Box, Dalek Lunchbox, whatever. But no, we are killing off the Daleks, goodbye Daleks.
Who else is nostalgic for the days when characters died and they bloody all, even major money-spinning villains died and they bloody well stayed dead? Even though they were brought back eventually.
Well, here's the even thing that we're not even tripping on for young listeners and people who are just entering the second Doctor for with new eyes like I am. We kind of, like, for people that have heard of Jamie McCurran, maybe heard the audios or maybe have seen references in later Doctor Who, he's still fairly young. So it's kind of interesting plot-wise how you're still in Gatwick Airport in the beginning, end up in freaking 1866 midpoint, and at the end of it, you end up in Scarrow. WTF!
Well, that is a good point to start on, the wonderful structure of...
What structure?
No, it is structured into a three-act story. First of all, and the way that the Daleks' plan unfolds, the only thing which confuses me is why is Waterfield, the father, working as an antiques dealer? I suppose he has to... An antiques dealer in 1966. I suppose that he has to have some kind of role, that he has to have a front in order to be there in 1966. So that the Doctor and Jamie won't just be meeting some random guy in the street. He has to set up this network in order to ensnare him and get the TARDIS. Then, as you say, that whole part in the beginning, the first two episodes, the mystery with the TARDIS and then the murder mystery. Yes, yeah. Let's meet at the Tricolor Cafe. Wonderful French pronunciation there, Patrick Troughton. God, yeah, I can't speak French. You know, that's that's the kind of French pronunciation you'd expect from a stereotypical working class English guy. But
good morning.
Yes. God, don't even get us started. But
with Tree Color Cafe, though, did you see, like, everyone just randomly dancing and then Jamie and the Doctor just kind of sitting there, like, very confused?
Yes, well, the obvious...
Like, a solid half a minute, that would never happen in modern television, where they're just doing nothing. They're just killing in air.
That's just to show the fact that, yes, they are sitting and waiting. They're just waiting for this guy, Ken something, to appear. Yes, I do absolutely adore the first two episodes. I adore the mystery of it and the little tips and hints that they gave. Jamie hearing the train for the first time. What the hell is that? He doesn't say hell, obviously, because it's BBC in the 1960s. It's a train. It's a train, Jamie. What? It's carriages pulled on wheels by a steam engine. And also, even though it was a reconstruction, the photographs, the images and caption still did a very good way of telesnaps. Still did a very good job of showing Waterfield, the father's, hesitance when he was handling a ham radio. Because Kennedy, the henchman, was following the Doctor, signalled Kennedy to base, and he very slowly, nervously picks it up like he's handling a priceless heirloom, even more cautiously than a priceless heirloom, because, yes, he's from the 1860s as well. The Daleks have explained this technology to him as part of their grand plan. It's amazing that, honestly, even though we see a Dalek for the first time at the end of the first episode, I genuinely wish that they'd given this serial a title such as The Human Factor.
Because
even you can tell, just like the Daleks were called Alpha, Beta, and Omega because it sounded better, especially when they were singing it. They called it the Evil of the Daleks purely because, as you say, Alex, it was the height of Dalek mania. It would get more views. But yes, when it's just the Doctor and Jamie following the trail of clues which Waterfield has set for them, another beautiful point. The fact that they think they're following the trail, but really it's a planted trail. You've got no idea that the Daleks are involved. So if you've just gone into it, the Human Factor, what the hell does this title mean? And then at the end of the first episode, you see a Dalek. Dun, dun, dun. That would have had even more impact. Of course, these are only the most minor, incidental niggles. Because then, after the end of the second episode, when the Jamie and the Doctor have been kidnapped, they're taken back to 1866, and this is when Act Two of the play, the real story begins.
Meat and potatoes, if you would, as they say in screenwriting.
Yeah, the meat and potatoes of the story.
Mm. That sounds rude.
Yes, I was just going to say that's what he said.
But yes, one of the anecdotes that that you often hear is Jamie has a reputation for always saying, "Look at the size of that, Doctor!" Like it's a kind of loose catchphrase. And we've reached the point where they dare to have outtakes, which they didn't in the Hartnell era. So originally, upon seeing on the first take of Fraser Hines beholding the Dalek Emperor, what he actually said was, "Look at the balls on that, Doctor!" which, it's not the only prank that occurred. Cause it's, well, I think one of the things that makes this era is, this cast really got along. They've got amazing chemistry. The bit where they find Victoria's handkerchief, there was a take where Patrick Troughton swapped a handkerchief for a pair of knickers. To explain, I mean ladies' underwear. And it was something like...
Panties.
A pair of knickers. Victoria must have come along here. I hope the footage exists somewhere, because that is a story that they tell at conventions.
Letters, is this a good segue to begin discussing Victoria?
Yeah.
Down, boy!
But doesn't everyone else agree that she should have been like Snow White with small tweeting birds and bunnies following her with every step she took?
Did Ponto die for her? I mean, come on.
Sorry?
Well, not Tonto. What was his real name? The random guy that couldn't speak.
The camel.
That
Persian dude.
Turkish,
sorry. It's just, like, Jamie and him got on pretty well, but as soon as she shows up, he's like, whatever. It's like, I'll protect you! Yeah, right. Yeah, and Victoria's just kind of sitting there, hanging out with essentially a mime, which isn't bad, but she's just talking to herself.
In my opinion, it's like whether or not you can watch telesnaps or whether or not you can watch a film with subtitles. I have absolutely no problem with that at all, because yes, it just demonstrates it would be better if the original episode, the live action, still existed, because then we could see that they are interactive. They know each other so well that Victoria just can, excuse me, Victoria simply can read Kamel's visual cues, his body language, his facial expressions, etc. They can have a conversation, yes, with Victoria doing the talking for both of them, and saying, yes, Kamel, you're right, blah, 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 to explain for the audience. There's a similar kind of relationship in between two of the minor bit part characters in Avatar: The Last Airbender. You know, the best Japanese anime ever to have been made in America. You know, it's an absolutely epic series, and it's basically the same thing. One of the characters is mute, or at the very least doesn't talk ever. So the other has conversations with him, very much in the same vein, and I believe that it works. the whole fact that Victoria was literally a damsel in distress, and you know, the fact that it was deliberately set up by the Daleks for her to be the damsel in distress, that was so cool. Now, Jamie, I don't want you trying to be a hero and running off, ruining everything by running off to save Victoria yourself. Don't go near the South Wing.
Yeah, it's basically the same kind of... the Doctor was totally on a bit. I mean, the entire thing of getting the memory of his whole visions of essentially putting a camera on his back and making sure that every single decision he made goes in these tubes, and then, saying, oh, it's a good day, long day's job work, and everyone was very suspicious after that point, especially with the whole three new Daleks thing, which we covered earlier.
Oh, but, it's not that Jamie is suspicious at that point. He is outright enraged. What? Mm-hmm. Two men are dead, a woman is possibly dead, and here you are talking about having a good night's work. This reminds me of a Hartnell episode, which you haven't seen, Ben. Okay. It's one of the most underrated episodes from one of the most underrated year of the Hartnell era. It's called The Massacre of St. Bartholomew's Eve. This was before Troughton. Towards the end of the Hartnell era, there was the idea of the Doctor as a hero. At this point, it was still Verity Lambert's original vision that the Doctor was a grumpy old explorer who didn't give a flying fig about humanity. Or individual, he cared about the timeline, but for him, preservation of history was far more important than individual human life. You see, so this is how it ties back to the Doctor saying, "Oh, that was a good night's work," and Jamie saying, "What?" You know, deliberately, obviously outraged at being used like that. Outraged at the fact that the Doctor is apparently willing to let people die as long as his experiments, as long as his grand vision is achieved. So in this serial, back when the Doctor was still a grumpy old explorer who was still far more concerned with the temporal prime directive, as they would call it in Star Trek, than with actually helping anyone. The companion, Stephen Taylor, my second favourite companion, male companion of all time after Jamie, after Fraser Hines, is... So they go back to 1745, I think it is. I'll have to check the date of the massacre of St. Bartholomew's Eve again. They go to Paris just when... that if you don't, any Americans, any British people, anyone in Europe who doesn't know, back during this period, there was violent sectarian hatred between Protestants and Catholics in Europe. The massacre of St. Bartholomew's Eve was the most, was the bloodiest massacre of Protestants by Catholics throughout that period. So they arrive there in that time. Throughout the serial, Stephen befriends a young woman, so it's very much like Jamie and Victoria. Stephen befriends Anne Shapley, a girl. And so Stephen doesn't have the faintest clue what the hell is going on. He knows nothing about the massacre that's going to happen. The doctor does. So when they have to leave, the doctor tells Anne to go to her aunt's house. She'll be safe there. The doctor and Stephen run back into the TARDIS just as the massacre is starting. And so in the TARDIS, the doctor, so Stephen asks, what's happened? What's going to happen to Anne? Well, tens of thousands were slaughtered in a single day in Paris. Then the massacre spread outwards, so I've got absolutely no idea what happened to her. You left her behind knowing that she was going to die. So again, this rage, people are dead and all you care about is your own work, your own vision, your grand design, whatever that may be. So again, Jamie says, when this is all over, I want nothing more to do with you. And again, this is throwing back to Stephen, because they're in the TARDIS at the time. The next place this TARDIS lands, I'm getting off. If your experiments have so, if your researchers have so little regard for human life, then I want no part of them. And that for me was the defining scene. Now, they changed it at the end so that Stephen stayed. And the doctor was absolved of moral responsibility. And so, yes, this scene in Evil of the Daleks, where Jamie is kind of echoing Stephen in the past, he sort of says, yes, I'm never going to talk to you again. I want nothing to do with you anymore. And then just sort of forgets about it. But then it was even more powerful.
Well, yeah. At least from Jamie's point of view, I don't know about the Stephen guy, because I'll have to look into it, but from what I saw with Evil the Daleks, Jamie at least doesn't forget about it. He more likely wants to hear why the Doctor believes what he believes, and then hears him out, asks another few questions, and then gets it.
Yes, I can definitely see that. You've got to remember, the difference here is that once they know Victoria is alive, that's right. The deal changer. Whereas,
Well, just besides that, when the Doctor, I don't think the first Doctor would ever do this, because I've seen a bit of the heart in Alara, but the second Doctor actually says, look, Jamie, this is what I value, and I'm sorry those other people had to die, but I never believed that the ends justify the means. He says that. First Doctor would never say that.
No, that is a point that the original Hartnell Doctor never explains himself. Again, right. There is the most magnificent scene after Stephen leaves with what should have been as the final time. As much as I adore the Savages, Stephen's actual last episode, because, as I say, at the end of Massacre of St. Bartholomew's Eve, they changed it so that Stephen would stay on board and that the Doctor would be absolved of this moral question mark hanging over whether Anne Shapley has survived. But Sorry, I've completely lost my train of thought there.
My point was, sorry to give you guys on track who are listening at home. My point with this episode is you get to see the second Doctor really explain himself, especially with the young new Daleks that have humanity in them.
Oh, yeah, so that was the point I was about to make. After Stephen's left, what we think is the final time, the Doctor gives the speech about how no one understands him. Well, because you never try to explain yourself. So it just goes to show how completely different Troughton's Doctor is from the original Hartnell Vision from Verity Lambert. Then everyone after, I think, Peter Davison is trying to create the Doctor from some kind of blending of Troughton and Baker.
But Troughton, at least, he doesn't have the grand speeches, but I love that scene where at first the Doctor, thinks that the Daleks are trying to, kill him, the humanized Daleks, and then all of a sudden he realizes, no, they're playing a game with me. James is a bit confused, but the Doctor's just spinning around, and he's like, oh, okay.
Busy Doctor, busy Daleks.
Yeah. Right, and but the problem is with that is, when you have a villain that everyone's making so much money off of, and they're considered like Nazis, and then you make them nice, it's weird.
That's ultimately the entire point of the episode. What if these Daleks were like children? And it's interesting. That's the way that they chose to portray the quote unquote humanized Daleks. To make them as innocent and childlike as possible, as a direct and absolute contrast to the absolute evil of the true Daleks. Well, again, that's another segment right there.
Yeah. Then there's the debate. Yeah, because I don't know. And also, keep in mind, Terry Nation, you figured he'd be on the script writing, but I'm looking on Wikipedia and he's not listed.
Oh, is this not, this must be the first Dalek story not by Terry Nation.
Yeah, this is written by David Whittaker.
Oh.
Yeah, Terry Nation is not involved at all.
Wow.
Yes, that is actually a very good point.
Because this is kind of a slight, as I say, new Doctor Who takes from this serial particularly, it's this new direction of human Daleks, Dalek humans.
There is also another point about the fact it's not written by Terry Nation, which we definitely need to explore.
Yeah, because he has a totally different interpretation of the Daleks. Yeah, and even the whole idea of the Emperor Dalek and the last Dalek at this is the end of the Daleks. Also, the references of the mirror thing is referenced in Turn Left, which you all remember from the David Tennant era, and other fun things. Especially the FASA Doctor Who role playing game talks about this episode.
Wow. Okay.
Yep. And I have it.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, but also the point. Go ahead, Ben. Yeah.
Oh, and there's also a cutscene from this episode that was supposed to be part of the third Doctor serial, which is very weird.
What?
According to this, a scene that was supposed to be in this was also supposed to be in the third Doctor serial, The Day of the Daleks. Would have actually starred the three Daleks that you saw when they're spinning around the Doctor.
I don't quite understand.
Oh, sorry. The third Doctor is supposed to have an episode called The Day of the Daleks, okay?
I know Day of the Daleks.
But there's a deleted scene cut of that episode where they were supposed to have those three Daleks in it.
Oh!
Yes!
I did not... Alpha, Beta, and Omega are supposed to turn up in the 70s. I had no idea.
That's what Wiki says.
That would be a fun invasion.
Oh, yeah.
But moving back from the nerd trivia to the actual interpretation of the Daleks, this is the first, I think this is the first time when we see when the Daleks are portrayed as mindless automatons. When Maxtable, for example, the owner of the house, the person who is the cause of, or who has done a deal with the Daleks in exchange for the secret of alchemy, turning base metals into gold. When he is given the Dalek factor, he becomes a mindless automaton who obeys without question, completely reworking, completely going in a different direction from Terry Nation's original vision of Nazis. Yes, the Nazis had a hierarchy. They were all, there were the common soldiers and there were the generals and there was the Führer, and you knew your place within that hierarchy. You obeyed your superior's orders without question. But this idea of the Daleks as mindless automatons, this is the one thing about the serial which simply doesn't work for me. It's because it reminds me of, it contrasts with their Goa'uld-esque nature. Okay, the Goa'uld in Stargate SG-1, they're all egomaniacal and power-hungry. They would kill every other Goa'uld if it meant that they could have supreme power. They don't care about each other at all. They are the ultimate narcissistic egomaniacs and sadists. Daleks care about their own species. But this idea that there is the supreme, that the Dalek, that the lower rank Daleks are mindless automatons who just obey and kill until they are given the human factor, which turns them into innocent children who just want to play trains and sing. That it works in the serial, but its contrasts, it just doesn't fit with Terry Nation's original vision of the Daleks. So this is the first time, really, beyond the constant, what does it mean to be a Dalek, what does it mean to be a human, that Russell T. Davis, later Moffat, would plough into the ground. This is one instance of the Daleks being reinterpreted, portrayed in a different way, like the Cybermen, as I've discussed in previous podcasts, the way that it's always a different interpretation of the villains, of the creatures, always exploring a different issue.
Definitely. You had some points you wanted to make, Alex? Or
I was going to say, a big fan theory, and this does come in the 70s and 80s, is that Daleks don't stop evolving. So and of course you end up with two different factions, if you remember. So there are deviations in Daleks. It's actually implied in Destiny of the Daleks that they've become a lot more robotic, that they're barely organic living beings at all. But that's Daleks from that time.
That would be the best kind of scientific, but not really, explanation to try and to explain away the fact that, yes, these Daleks are different, that we are exploring a different aspect of the Daleks, that the Daleks are being used to explore a different philosophical question.
I think that the best use of Daleks was actually in the 80s, we haven't got to it yet, where human fascists, where these days I suppose we'd say UKIP, but yes, the 1960s version of UKIP and Nigel Farage actually up with
the National Front. And yes, I can't remember the name, but the episode with the Hand of Omega, etc., I think it was the Silver Anniversary serial. Not only was that one of Sylvester McCoy and Ace's best serials ever, that was also one of the best Dalek stories. Kind of makes me wish that... Well, no, there are many, many things that make me wish that Doctor Who hadn't been rebooted.
Yeah.
But, the scene at the end, we did good, didn't we, Doctor? Only time will tell. But anyway, yes, Ben, go ahead.
Oh, sorry, as a side note, do you guys remember when the Doctor just regenerated?
Oh, you mean the 10th Planet?
Yeah, the guy who wrote the 10th Planet wasn't Terry Nation either. It was the same guy, David Whittaker, just as a side note.
Yeah.
No, 10th Planet wasn't David Whittaker.
No?
He might have written the Target novelization. I think that's what's tripping you up.
Oh, okay.
Jerry Davis and Kip Hedlund.
Oh, 10th Planet. Okay, never mind.
A lot of Target novelizations are by David Whittaker, including Unearthly Child. So if you're going by the novelizations, that's not... You've got to look under episodes on Wikipedia.
Sorry about that. No,
go ahead.
Back to Evil the Daleks for a minute. No, I appreciate Silver Nemesis. It's amazing. I love Sylvester McCoy. He's my doctor. Anyway, back to this plot. I think the only weird thing is the whole, like, the professor guy who's in 1860 and has the giant thingies, and he has the whole hypnotist thing that will be revisited with the Master.
Yes, I wanted to discuss him as well, because although this is a Dalek serial, he is the main villain.
Yeah.
Yeah. The Daleks are not necessarily bit players, but they're not really puppet masters either. You know, at the beginning, we think that Waterfield, Victoria's father, is the main villain because he's the one controlling everything. But no, he is being unwittingly controlled by Maxtable, who has in turn sold his soul to the Daleks. Ah, yes, don't worry, I can make a deal with the Daleks. The last 50 evil, stupid people may have been exterminated, but their problem was that they weren't evil and stupid enough. And for all of the things to be willing to sell out your own family, your friends, your entire species for, the secret of turning lead into gold, come on, that has got to be the most cliche ghetto motivation in human history. Come on, you're 60 years old plus in the 1860s. You've got a couple of years left to live. I would have thought immortality would have been slightly higher on your list.
But what if they could have produced a lump of purest green? Only Blackadder fans will get that. I assume you both did.
Oh, yeah. No, the thing I always imagined was, like what had destroyed the episode, I think, was as soon as he said to the Daleks, well, could you have something that turned lead into gold? They'd be like, excuse me for one moment, let me get a ray. 5 seconds later, here you go.
Oh, but that's the point, though. The fact that the Daleks don't keep their promises. As I say, the last 50 evil, stupid people who tried to do a deal with the Daleks were exterminated, but their problem was not being evil or stupid enough. That they use the promise of it to string Maxtable along, and Maxtable's greatest flaw is that he is stupid enough, and he is greedy and stupid enough to believe them. It's called the Evil of the Daleks, but this is just If the Daleks really are, as is portrayed in the serial in particular, if they really are just mindless automatons who obey the Emperor and kill without question, that's not really evil. You can't blame an individual Borg for killing or assimilating people any more than you can blame a virus for reproducing and killing healthy cells along the way. But Maxtable, follows what I define as evil, being deliberately harming other people entirely for your own selfish ends. You know, he's willing to sacrifice Waterfield, his daughter, his own family, that is a point. The three bit part characters in the 1860s aspect of this, Maxtable's daughter, the maid Molly, and the fiance of Maxtable's daughter, Arthur. He is under Dalek control because he has the black box on the back of his neck. But he won't eat or drink anything. How does that work? That's the other kind of, whoa, what? Are you sure you've got that here? Because the whole scene, the way that Arthur is constantly switching between being mind controlled by the Daleks and being his normal self, confused, in pain, obviously, because the Daleks are speaking to him. Yeah. And the whole scene where the Doctor picks, you know, he and the Doctor have swords. Look, this sword, it's magnetic, that takes it away from Arthur. Now it's not. What? So is Arthur a robot? What? The box on his back of it, on the back of his neck, can't make his arm magnetic, for God's sake. And, you know,
He could be like Rory.
Oh, no, but then at the end of his story arc, when basically they've got too many characters and they need to get rid of them with very little explanation, just take the control box off the back of his neck and he's a normal human again. You know, send him off far away as possible with fiancé and maid. And who, what, where, when, why? You know, it's hard to see why they were even in the story in the first place. Like the robber who was being paid by Arthur, but then wasn't paid because he spoke, because one time he was being controlled by the Daleks, the other time he wasn't. That whole arc there is the whole thing with Arthur is just so completely deranged and confused. It is by far the weakest part of the story. Fortunately, though, the main plot with Maxtable is strong enough that this whole subplot with Arthur, is he human, is he an android, is he under Dalek control, but why isn't he eating or drinking anything? That line screams android, replaced by android, but no, he's still human. What? You know, even if you aren't under Dalek mind control, why would not eating or drinking anything make a difference? No, because remember, the Daleks did make an android of the Doctor in the chase. This part of the script was completely botched before they went to film it. This part of the script was botched. But as I say, though, the main plot with Maxtable as the villain, Victoria's father as the reluctant accomplice, as he puts it, the silent partner aiding and abetting, just to try and save his daughter. Oh, yes, hinting at the fact, that remembering that it's the 1960s, my one goal is to see my daughter safe, and then I shall confess everything. For those who aren't familiar with Victorian society, when he says that, pausing slightly, his voice dropping and bowing his eyes slightly, he is saying that he will confess to God. In other words, he will kill himself and face punishment for his sins.
So he's saying, wait, hold on, he's committing seppuku?
The concept of seppuku does not exist in Victorian England, but that is the polite, gentlemanly way of saying that, yes, I will kill myself. So that kind of takes away the impact of his death on Skaro, because he was, even though he was killed by the Daleks, he was determined to die regardless, because yes, it was seppuku. He had dishonored himself, he had dishonored his family, he was willing to sell, he was on the verge of selling out an entire planet just to save his daughter. So once his daughter is safe, then yes, seppuku. And he was such a great character, as I say. You're going to impregnate these Daleks with the best of humanity, you know, human courage and nobility, along with their alien intelligence and absolute evil. You know, we can't do this. We will be sacrificing an entire planet. It was too late when you kidnapped me and Jamie. It was too late 20 steps ago. It's a bit late to be getting squeamish now, Waterfield.
Yeah. I don't know. Like, what do you think the subplot of the whole my boyfriend is a Cyberman aspect?
My theory is the whole magnetic thing and never eating and drinking screams android. Because, again, you won't have seen this, in the serial The Chase, the Doctor is copied by the Daleks. The Daleks do have the technology to create perfect functioning humanoid androids which have the appearance and memories and personality of the original.
Seventh Doctor did that. Yeah, okay. Yeah.
So they were obviously trying to do that, but then at the end of Act 2 of the serial, the 1866 serial, they needed them all away, and the android version is destroyed. But Molly, daughter of Maxtable, and fiance go to Paris, what have you. But then, how does that explain the fact that they were trying to do this whole thing where they each time they spoke to a person, they spoke to Arthur in inverted commas. One time they were talking to the android, the other time they were talking to the real Arthur, hence the robber being paid to kidnap Jamie. That point still makes no sense. So, as I say, they were trying to do something. So one, the original thought that it would be an android. The next thought was that he would be mind-controlled. But The two subplots got meshed together, and there was just no proofreading. No one stopped. You know, this was the 1960s equivalent of Kill the Moon, because no one checked the plot. No one said, "Hang on a second, this doesn't make any sense whatsoever. Why are you kidnapping Jamie except to introduce a character who literally doesn't need to exist?" You know, Arthur You could remove Arthur entirely and just have the maid and the and Maxtable's daughter and say, okay, there's evil in this house, leave. But then, so then you had to have Arthur in order to save him, to get him away from there, a reason for the daughter to leave without her father, blah, blah, blah.
I think I can explain. It's that serials were planned either to be four-parters or six-parters. That's the formula at this point.
So
the fact it's a seven-parter means something happened where, shit, we need another weeks of television.
Yes, that definitely explains it. The fact that, yes, I was actually going to say, you could cut out all of the rubbish with Arthur and cut this down to a six-week serial. That would have made it much better. But no, they extended it to 7 weeks. So they did indeed have to simply throw in all of this bollocks, even though it was only a single screenwriter or one single credited screenwriter, it was just thrown together at the last minute. Fortunately, though, as I say, the actual plot with Maxtable, Waterfield and the Doctor and Jamie and Victoria is... still strong enough. You know, you could literally, this is one of the few cases. There are times when serials feel too long, but it's still a coherent story. In this case, all of the crap with the daughter and her fiance could be removed entirely. Cut it down to a six. Cut it down to six episodes. Everything's hunky dory.
Can I add in a few, if you don't mind?
Obviously.
Thank you. The overall series itself is fantastic, even though they add in an extra one. My only criticism, besides the whole my boyfriend is so-and-so or mind control or whatever, I just feel like Victoria as a character doesn't really do much.
No, that is the point I wanted to make. You know, is this a good segue to talk about Victoria?
I think we should talk about Victoria, who is, well, she's Victoria the Victorian.
Yeah.
She's written to be of her time. This is her introduction of the character. Well, I'd actually say this era of Doctor Who with the Doctor, Jamie and Victoria is going to be excellent.
Yes, but in the beginning... Yeah. I do have this major feeling of guilt. What? This is your favourite, one of your favourite female companions, possibly my, yes, probably my favourite female companion of all time.
Because
it's tied with Leela. But my problem is, yes, she is a Snow, at this point, she is entirely and solely a Snow White damsel in distress. Aside from her scene with Kemmel in the Dalek prison where she's doing all of the talking for both of them, I think that works. Ben doesn't. She doesn't really have a personality. When she's actually feeding the birds on the windowsill and the Dalek comes in and commands her to eat. Come on. As I say,
do not feed the flying pests outside.
Yes, as I say, she should have little bunnies and birds following her everywhere she goes, like Snow White, because this whole divine, pure, angelic thing is... It's just so grossly overdone. No, she does develop as a character, honestly.
What is your name?
Yeah.
I think Victoria Waterfield. I think her sisters are Elsa and Anna. okay, opening up the floor if anyone has anything left to say.
This is almost a White Knight Jamie story. Like, you could not have the Daleks wire him up via headsets and see what he does. I mean, if he stripped away everything, it's basically Jamie's in the middle of the Highlands and see a young damsel in distress. He's got to go save her.
Yes,
Victoria in England.
I do like the way that the traditional damsel in distress trope was used.
Right.
But, yes, it is, dude, you're just pining after her because she's the sweet, innocent, virginal princess. She does develop later, it's the underwater menace effect. No, it's not honestly this bad.
I want to say, I was more bothered by this because it is a trope. Oh God, the non-white character,
yes.
who is the strong, silent type, yada yada yada.
That is it. That has to be its own segment when we come back.
Okay, because I hope we don't get that anytime soon. And it's worse. Yeah. So, what are people's thoughts on the character Kemmel?
We've still got a long way to go when it comes to racial equality, ethnic equality, but damn, we've come a long way. Sorry, Ben, go ahead.
He can write, at least.
He can write.
He's really good. He helps out Jamie a lot. He can do things.
Yeah, but still, oh God, the way that Maxtable introduces him. Yes, his mind is undeveloped. He's quite dumb. Dumb, the original meaning, the original definition of mute, not being able to speak for our American friends. But yes, he, far from being the stupid ape-like creature, which Maxtable introduced him as. He, as Ben points out, he is capable. He is heroic.
He dies for the cause.
Yeah. But still, this idea of the noble savage, it, in a way, the fact that he is made given humanity and so forth is even worse from a... white dominated check your privilege social justice warrior perspective, because the idea that no, the others might be ignorant half human creatures, but no, this one's good, this one this one is noble, this one is heroic. He's the house nigger, basically.
Ouch.
To use the American parlance.
Well, I mean, if you want to go in that territory, Americans are actually banning bits of Mark Twain now because of the N-word.
Yeah,
Americans are very weird.
I don't agree with censorship precisely because Americans... You know, through that literature, we need to look back and see just how bad things really were and still are. The only problem with things like the portrayal of Kemmel in this episode and the blatant use of the N-word in Mark Twain is that people look at that and think, oh, yes, there's no such thing as racism now. No, it's become more insidious, it's become less blatant, but it's still there. And the fact that we don't recognize it is the fact we don't recognize that it exists is the problem. But yes, Kemmel is the portrayal of Kemmel, although they do try to salvage it. Why couldn't it have been a gigantic white muscle man?
My question. Because if you want to go full out, go on full out. I mean, people with blacker skin in England, it's not as big of an issue, is it?
I'd say basically...
It's not as big of an issue, but the racism is still highly prominent. It's still an issue everywhere.
But you don't have an entire month dedicated to racism.
Sorry?
I mean, in America, we have friggin' February, where, like, NBC and all these big corporations have to admit, oh, yeah, by the way, yeah, we have to have an entire month talking about how cool black people are.
Yes, don't pretend that that's a bad thing, Ben, because, yes, oh, if we have a Black History Month, then why don't we have a White History Month? No, we have every book and every class and every TV show in every history TV show in America devoted to white history, aside from slavery, the Jim Crow laws, and Martin Luther King.
No. In the United States, we're the only... I live in a country where everyone self-labels themselves. Like, even this, he walks into the room and it's like, this is my dumb Turk. It's like, no, this person's kind of low set, or he'll be afraid of his dialect, but he doesn't necessarily know what's going on. That's different versus, like, if this was Lost in Space equivalent, you would have had someone like, well, you know, this person's dumb because they don't know any better because they're always like that. There's a bit of a difference, I'm just saying.
The fact that this was British racism as opposed to British racism as opposed to American racism is noted. Oh, God. The fact that... sorry, I just have to mention Star Trek because we're talking about race. Oh,
there
yes, we're three white guys talking about race. It's one, two... One, two, three. Check our privilege! But the fact that Uhura in the original Star Trek was basically the ship's secretary, and Guinan in Next Generation was the mystical Negro trope. Fortunately, that was counterbalanced by Geordi LaForge, but still, there's... Oh, God, we're just looking back on it from the 21st century, 50 years later, saying, dude, oh, God, were we that bad?
For Doctor Who, they've had Mickey, they've tried to do it since. I mean, come on.
I know, I'm not saying, I am not saying Doctor Who is racist. I'm just saying cultural attitudes back in the 1960s, back in Mark Twain's era. Yeah, it's like the fact, Alex, something you'll appreciate, the fact that Oscar Wilde was grossly anti-Semitic.
Yeah, that is a shame that there's, if you read the book Dorian Gray, there are these references to ghastly little Israelites and things like that. Interestingly, there's an episode of Colditz, it's a very late episode of Colditz, where the Nazis are discussing the British and still thinking that they'll win us over. That the Nazis and the British would be allies at some point. And there's a line like, look at their literature. You know they hate the Jews too. Which, yes, you find it in Dickens, you find it in Wilde, you find it in Shakespeare. Our literature, yeah, there is a lot of anti-Semitism in
Oh, yes, the idea that Germany was the only anti-Semitic nation in Europe is total bullshit. Yes, it is a historical fact. That if you look at Robert Mosley, The Rise of the British Union of Fascists, was it Robert Mosley?
Anyway. Not Robert. Oh, count. What was his first? Fuck, it's going to annoy me.
It's got about 17 different names, but
it's not Robert. It's not Edward. Hang on, Oswald.
Oswald, thank you. Why did I call him Robert? But if you look at Robert, I still call him Robert. Oswald Mosley and the Rise of the British Union of Fascists, there's a very good chance that we would have been the anti-Semitic tyranny whilst Germany was still a democracy if history had gone slightly differently. But getting back to the, but it just goes to show, up until anti-Semitism was completely destroyed and discredited by the Holocaust, it's just like race at overt segregation, things like the Jim Crow laws, etc., were completely overturned by the civil rights movement, Martin Luther King, Malcolm X. You can't be overtly anti, these were massive declarations. You can't be overtly, explicitly, blatantly racist anymore. You can't be overtly, explicitly, and blatantly anti-Semitic. But then we see in things like Doctor Who and Star Trek, progressive shows, which at the to this day, the original Star Trek and TNG were praised. Whoopi Goldberg appears in an interview with William Shatner, the guy who and other members of main members of the cast from both series of Star Trek, original and TNG, saying, oh, yes, because Uhura was my inspiration to be a mystical Negro trope. Again, check my privilege explaining to a black woman. But the fact that, yes, Kemmel in the 1960s was progressive. Uhura in the 1960s was progressive. This is how far we still have to go.
I actually was thinking about Star Trek recently because I've been wanting to do a podcast about a BBC One film that's just aired on Boxing Day called The Boy in the Dress. And when thinking, do I review this, do I do a podcast of this, I remembered the pilot for TNG. Because, of course, if you remember the original series, original Star Trek, a lot of legs in classic Star Trek.
The fact that in TNG, the pilot of TNG, many of the male officers were wearing skirts, basically.
They wore miniskirts,
I'm really sad that they dropped that.
I think it's disappointing. That's what I'm saying.
It's a wonderful example of the fact that, yes, Starfleet is multicultural. So given different cultures of forms of dress, oh, God, I would love, just once, the franchise is dead now, but to have seen a Sikh helmsman or what have you, red uniform to designate that they're in the command section of the crew, and also a red turban, or a female Muslim helmswoman with a red hijab.
But yeah, I mean, even. Well, Doctor Who's not military. Doctor Who's like...
We're not talking... It was just an example of... We're going into... We were talking about multiculturalism and diversity.
No. If you really want to be multicultural, like, in that... I mean, it's military. Like, of course you're going to have, like, all these different garbs and different things and people working together and utopian society. That was the whole Star Trek thing.
Yeah, but what I'm saying is, especially for a series that went out of its way in its historical period, I'm thinking here specifically of the Aztecs. No, they weren't simply bloodthirsty monsters. There was that aspect of their society which they explored in depth, but then there was Ortloc. you may not have saved an entire civilization, but at least you saved one man. Returning to Doctor Who, although we wouldn't see a black Although we wouldn't see a black companion until the new era, what's his name? Russell's era.
Russell T. Davis.
I wanted to call him David T. Russell. Although we won't see a black companion until the Russell T. Davis era with Mickey and Martha, although even then all of the companions will be from contemporary 21st century London. There was diversity. There was a genuine attempt at inclusiveness. There was no overt racism, but I think my point is, in a way, that's what makes it worse. Very much like the director of Dallas Buyers Club saying, "Are there any transgender actresses out there?" That was me facepalming, by the way. But
sorry, hang on. Dallas Buyers Club has its own jar.
Okay, that's another Pansy UNICEF. Yeah. But it is just so problematic, especially looking. The lesson is, yes, it looks bad, but don't forget what there is to learn from characters like Kemal and the other quote unquote noble savage character in Tomb of the Cybermen. Yeah, the fact that in the 1960s, when this was being made, nobody batted an eyelid. Nobody really thought, hey, this is racist. And, you know, remind us to take a good hard look at ourselves today, to take a step back. You know, in 50 years, will people look at what we're saying and doing now and say, Jesus Christ, for the love of God, dude, how could you have not known that this was racist, sexist, homophobic, or what have you?
Well, if you want to do a Doctor Who style thing of someone comes in the TARDIS and checks out nowadays, I think the most thing they'd trip on is, wait, you're still tripping the whole asexuality thing.
Okay.
Well, I've got no idea what you're... Again, this is the point, though, Ben. We've got absolutely no idea what you're talking about there, so...
Oh, yeah. No, seriously. Do you want this in the podcast? I can talk about it on the podcast. It's awesome. Seriously, it's going to be in the future. Trust me.
Something about asexuality?
Oh, yeah. So, basically, asexuals... I'm not going to go on a tangent here, but we've gone on a tangent anyway, so might as well tell you. For all those people that don't know... Asexuality is the next frontier in sexualism. It's the future. It's the frontier. People from the far distance of reality in the future will know about this. And for all the people listening at home, let me explain. So basically, these are individuals that are part of the LGBT community, which you've probably heard about, trans.
I'm a GSD individual. Right. I do want to point out there are no asexuals in this podcast.
Right, but... People listening, I mean, I have some friends who are asexual. Basically, it's people that just don't get it. That just basically are like, why are you even mentioning sexuality at all? It's like, they have their own flag, they have their own thing. It's a thing, trust me.
But again, the next big thing in sexuality is going to be polyamory. Well,
But I mean, people that don't want to deal with it at all and rather just hang out and play video games and watch Doctor Who all evening. And don't really wonder why people have sex in the first place.
Right, okay. Well, asexuality would be an interesting avenue if we were talking about the 12th Doctor, because he contrasts his predecessor. The 11th Doctor being a very sexual and sometimes even sexually intimidating character. And according to Stephen Moffat, both the 11th Doctor and River Song were bisexual, although it's only subtly alluded to. Whereas the 12th Doctor seems to have no idea, like, what, you know, the joke about the dark water in swimming pools, why? Which I actually like. I like making the Doctor asexual again, because you don't need it.
I mean, he's asexual from the get-go. Like, the Doctor, from his point of view, he does not care about his female companion sexually at all. He views them as, he's a teacher, and he's gonna, even First Doctor, like, he's the old, grumpy old man, and then there's the family unit, and he's gonna tell Nell's granddaughter how things are, back in the good old days.
Yeah, well, I think if part of your brief is is Narnia, then it makes sense that the classic... Actually, I have an anecdote about this. Mm. When Carol Ann Ford reprised the role of Susan for the 20th anniversary episode The Five Doctors, she objected to the script, and she almost didn't do it, because the script had Susan calling the Doctor the Doctor. And she remembered from, 15 years earlier, no, Susan never called the Doctor Doctor. She only called him Grandfather. Yeah. What is the reason for this? And they said, oh, well, the Doctor can't have had sex. You can't ever suggest that the Doctor has had sex. It's a policy.
Right.
The Doctor is asexual. And if you call him Grandfather, that means he's had sex, he's been married, he's had children... not allowed. The Doctor must be kept asexual. And and a lot of people, when the American Doctor Who was made, and there were two kisses on the lips between the Doctor and Grace, a lot of fans hated that. But Carol Ann Ford, and credit where credit's due, stood her ground, and it was, she called him Grandfather, or I'm not going to be in this, and they changed the script for her.
Right.
But that's how serious they were. You can't, the Doctor's granddaughter can't even call him Granddad, or Grandpa, or Grandfather, because that means he's had sex.
Really?
But, how do we know how Gallifreyans actually breed?
Actually, there's an audio with John Pertwee that alludes to the Doctor's genitals. He's actually naked on an operating table, and Paradise of Death. Radio series from the year John Pertwee died, I think, which actually also has Liz Sladen. It's a Third Doctor and Sarah Jane Smith audio, which was on BBC Radio 4, which I think you can still get. And yes, they allude to the Doctor not having the same kinds of genitals that humans do.
So, this... yes, thus concludes the nerd trivia segment of this podcast.
Yeah, about 50% of this podcast has been about Evil of the Daleks. So actually, I'm going to rein us in. Okay, Ben, high point, low point, Evil of the Daleks.
High point, low point. I forgot what we were talking about. All right. Evil of the Daleks. Gotta love the fuzzy hair. Jamie finally doing his stuff on his own, hanging out with the Second Doctor, and it's all fun. Low point, I just wish Victoria had something to do instead of just screaming out her name every other second.
Yes, what? This is your favorite companion? But anyway, say goodbye then.
She's in her infancy. We'll do final thoughts and goodbye, Doctor.
Oh, yeah.
So James, your high point, low point, Evil of the Daleks.
My high point has that's a difficult one, because the serial is just so damn good. I would have to say my high point is the mystery at the beginning. I do absolutely love when they're chasing this Ken someone, the Tricolour Cafe, etc. The low point is the completely botched subplot with Arthur, Maxtable's daughter, and Molly just thrown in there. Is he an android or is he mind controlled? Make up your damn mind, sort out the script accordingly. But of course, they simply didn't have time.
And I'd say I think that the whole thing, I agree about the beginning of the mystery. It is a superbly written mystery. I agree that the title shouldn't have contained the word Dalek,
Because the reveal of Daleks is always at the end of episode one, with all of them.
Yes.
So just stop doing... there are people who skip episode one when they watch and review Dalek serials, because they know. It's like... the opening episode is almost always... Actually, in this instance, maybe not superfluous, because it's just so well done. The mystery, the suspense. I mainly like how epic it is, but you don't... Obviously, it's a reconstruction. They don't have the final part with the big battle. But this is an epic, awesome serial. Is it this, or is it Dalek's master plan? It's a toss-up between them in terms of epic and awesome.
I obviously... Come on, you've got suicide, you've got death, you've got the despair at the end. For me, it's Dalek Master Plan, but that's just the Korean cinema lover in me.
I do love how Victoria is the second orphaned companion we have after Vicky, and they've got the same name, technically. Victoria...
The fact that Tom Baker accidentally calls... when he's talking to Sarah Jane Smith, he means Victoria, but he says Vicky. What? getting them to...
Oh, because, yes.
Because Sarah Jane Smith is wearing one of Victoria's old dresses. Oh, hello, Vicky.
And the emotionality of the character... Because it's not rookie writing this season. Mm-hmm. When we go into the next season, they don't try and sweep things. It's a bit odd that Victoria wears a knee-length skirt in the next serial.
Yeah.
Because a Victorian woman just takes to wearing a knee-length skirt like a duck to water. And there were Victorian men who fainted if they saw an ankle. You can't just suddenly go,
the whole... Victorian women wearing trousers, etc., whilst travelling was accepted, as long as you were outside of quote-unquote polite society. This is the big problem trying to understand Victorian morality. How much of it is what was actually believed? And what individuals actually believe, and how much is what was enforced as the social norm. You know, if it's like if you watch the film version of Dorian Gray, which you showed me, yes, it's all polite, prim and proper, with floor length dresses and Prince Albert piercings to ensure that you don't get an erection in public, but upstairs behind closed doors it's all BDSM and fucking mother and daughter in the same room almost at the same time. So
a lot of hypocrisy, but Victoria is young, she's been raised to be prim and proper. And, of course, girls don't even have pubes, don't forget. Men fainted on their wedding nights. Girls have pubic hair?
Yeah, the point is, again, going back to the TV series, it's artistic license. You can't have Victoria in a floor-length dress every time. It's a 1960s TV show. Deal with it. It's like Leela wearing a floor length dress for one serial.
I did want to come to the emotionality of the character, which we see in the next serial, where Patrick Troughton has a wonderful speech about grief, about missing dead loved ones, which is gives Tomb of the Cybermen that extra kind of little bit of magic. And
it's like, as I've mentioned, confusing Sarah Jane Smith for Victoria, although he says Vicky. And again, that suggests it might have been It might have been deliberate on the writer's part because he's confused Vippy and Victoria in his own mind. Because,
well, he's several hundred years older.
Exactly. So it's all become a blur. All of these people he's known who are, depending on where he visits them in the timeline, long dead now. Yeah,
and Victoria just coming out of nowhere and other timelines and wibbly wobbly timey wimey stuff. You know what I mean?
Yeah, and I also want to say, of course, in the new series this is referenced, because in The Snowmen, the 11th Doctor hears the name Great Intelligence, and he says, "Ooh, that rings a bell." So if you're looking at, because it's over a millennia for the Doctor, since he was the second Doctor. So the Great Intelligence, which is rather sad, because that suggests that by the time we get to now, the Doctor has forgotten Jamie, forgotten Victoria, forgotten, you know, all the lives that the Doctor may have forgotten. But if you lived a millennia, in fact, they do that in School Reunion, that the sadness of being, to explain to James, School Reunion is the one that reintroduced Sarah Jane Smith.
Yeah.
You know, companions age and die. The line actually is, "You can spend the rest of your life with me, I can't spend the rest of my life with you." Which is, the tragedy of being the Doctor.
Yeah, as I say, it was all explored beautifully in Tom Baker's speech at the beginning of Pyramids of Mars. So why do we need a new Doctor Who? Sorry, but I was going to say something, but no, I think this podcast is already way too long.
It's actually like the episode itself, where it's just a little bit long.
To explain to people, we record the show a week in advance, so this is these are people who have just had Christmas, and so everything's all over the place. Next week, and I think my low is the racism, mainly because it is a Doctor Who trope. Next week, fuck me, it's racist. And we waited, because that was discovered in 1993 when I was 12. They discovered all four episodes of Tomb of the Cybermen in Hong Kong. And the anticipation, because it's the only time, at that point it was the only time a full serial had resurfaced. And everyone knew it was awesome. Tomb of the Cybermen is as awesome as Evil of the Daleks. It is it all exists now. It's a classic. But when we saw it for the first time, oh no, it is face-palmingly racist. And the fact that they're back to back, they're both awesome, but they both have the sort of trope of the non-Caucasian silent type. Noble savage.
And not even that. The villain is Middle Eastern.
Well, both of them. Because there's two, aren't there?
Yeah, sorry.
Yeah.
The villains, plural, are Middle East. The villains are Middle Eastern. They've got a black slave, basically.
The black guy, sorry for the spoilers, people, but the trope of the black guy who sacrifices himself to save all the white people.
Yeah.
Checklist every racial trope. And so, yes, not that Doctor Who has black characters who have to sacrifice themselves for the greater good anymore. And so, I'll count that as my final thought, and I will say ta-ta, people. So, Ben, your final thought and goodbye.
Jamie's always awesome. I wish the actor playing Jamie still to this day, he's always good.
Can I ask, is awesome something everybody says where you live, or is that just you?
You mean awesome.
But I've twice heard you pronounce it awesome.
I think it's just a New Jersey thing.
Oh, okay. And James, your final thoughts and goodbye.
An absolutely spectacular serial. Like, just as the Daleks master plan was hindered, not ruined, hindered by the fact that they stretched it out to 12 episodes and then had to record something for Christmas and New Year. Evil of the Daleks is hindered by the, even though they try to use it intelligently, cleverly, kind of in a self-referencing way, the damsel in distress trope, Victoria basically just being a Snow White princess at this point, the racism of Kemmel, it could have been a white character just as easily, with no inherent problems, a white Eastern European, but then prejudice, bigotry against Eastern Europeans would have been an issue, and the massive, completely unnecessary and totally messed up, badly written, completely fucked up subplot with Arthur, the fiance of Maxtable's daughter. They hinder the story, but just like the Daleks' master plan, the main story is just so magnificent that these are little more than quibbles. And may the great holy donkey bless your house and your new year for seven generations.
Everybody.
Sorry?
It's going to be the year of the sheep.
Hooray for the year of the sheep. Not the great holy donkey, but the sheep. Okay, so yes, and yes, some classic Doctor Who was written in Biro at the last minute, and we need an extra episode. What? Oh, fuck. So, yeah. And so, next week we will be discussing The Tomb of the Cybermen.